Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of At the Scent of Water by Linda Nichols, narrated by James Jenner and directed by Brandon Schultz. Recorded Books Inspirational is an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. This book is copyrighted 2004 by Linda Nichols. This recording is copyrighted 2005 by Recorded Books. The author opens this book with the following quote from the Book of Job, chapter 14, verses 7 through 9. At least there is hope for a tree. If it is cut down, it will sprout again, and its new shoots will not fail. Its roots may grow old in the ground, and its stump die in the soil, yet at the scent of water it will bud and put forth shoots like a plant. And now, At the Scent of Water.
Prologue. The birthday club had been meeting at the inn at Smoky Hollow for 5 years now. Ordinarily, they would have rotated. Each year, the June birthdays would go somewhere different to celebrate. But Jenny's was the only June birthday left since Evelyn had died. And for 5 years now, she'd chosen the inn, even though she didn't particularly care for pan-fried trout, and the meals were a mite dear. It was a fancier place than she was used to, but still, she chose it. All because of the man at the corner table, who wasn't here yet. She saw the waitress place the silver napkins, position the water glasses just so, arrange the bottle in the ice bucket, the same setup every year. Jenny glanced toward the doorway. Still nothing. She returned her attention to Cora, who was waiting for Jenny to make over the subscription to TV Guide Cora had gotten her. Jenny hardly ever turned on the television anymore and could barely see to read her large print Bible. But Cora was a creature of habit. Jenny returned the favor and bought Cora a subscription each December when Cora's birthday rolled around. Cora wouldn't buy such a thing for herself, but she'd curl up and die without a crossword. She carried it around in her purse and was prone to pull it out at odd moments and fill in a line or two. Jenny didn't see how it could take a person more than 5 minutes or so to work the entire thing, but that was Cora for you. Come up with the right answer, then fiddle and fret for an hour before she wrote it down. Now, are you absolutely positive it was Linda Pearl that was the first daughter on Matlock? Because I thought it was that other one, the red-headed gal. And so on. Jenny plastered on a huge smile and patted Cora's hand. An old, veined hand. She looked at her friend's face, the skin creased and parchment thin, and she was stabbed with tenderness. Cora had been her friend for nearly all of her 79 years, as had the others, since they were girls together in Sunday school class. Nearly 80 years of heartaches and happiness, of courtships and marriages, of births and deaths, sorrows and joys, of birthdays. Thank you, darling, Jenny said. And Cora beamed, no doubt thinking Jenny was tearing up over the tender gift. You're as welcome as rain, Cora answered, thumping the TV guide with a knotted finger. I knew you'd be expecting it. Jenny smiled, a real one this time, and watched her friends fondly as they chatted on around her. The years had scattered them from the small town of their beginnings, and these birthday outings were their chance to catch up. Marie was telling Laura about her great-grandson. He'd gotten into some big school, and she was about to burst her buttons with pride. Cora, not to be outdone, interjected that her great-granddaughter had made the fourth grade honor roll for the third semester in a row. Jenny turned her eyes back toward the door. that piece of glass they'd put in since last year, 3/4 of a wall of frosted flower etching, was cramping her style. All she could see were legs and tops of heads. Here came a bunch of them, a whole knot of women's sandals, men's big feet, and a couple of children's chubby legs. She watched hopefully. Maybe he'd hooked up with the lady at the empty chair, and they'd come back this year with the whole family to celebrate. The legs and heads came around the corner. Ginny scanned them quickly. None were familiar. They filed in, a huge clump, and sat at the big round table in the middle. The corner was still empty. The waitress came around with refills. "More decaf?" she asked, holding the orange-rimmed pot in her hand. "Oh, I'd better not," Cora said. "I won't sleep a wink." Ginny exchanged a glance with Marie, but neither one of them said a thing. That was Cora, dingy as a bat. Marie checked her watch, and Ginny felt a pinch of anxiety. Crossing paths with the dark-haired man was getting harder and harder the older she got. She fretted again, but comforted herself with the fact that he had never missed showing up. Every year he came in at 7:15, took the chair facing the doorway at the corner table, sipped an iced tea, and waited. The first year had been awful to see. That was the year his plight had captured Ginny's heart. That was the year he'd brought the little box and the roses. Deep crimson roses. A full dozen long-stemmed. He'd set them on the table by the empty chair and sat there, the ice melting in his tea, his heart and eyes raw and wounded. Oh, she'd like to have died for him, watching the minutes tick by. After 20 or so, he'd taken out the little box, flipped it open, looked at it, then closed it back up again and put it in his pocket. Oh, how her heart had ached. And his face. It showed everything, that face. Hope in his eyes, guilt and despair in the lines from nose to mouth, a hint of anger in the set of his jaw and mouth. That's when she had begun to pray for him, the dark-haired man. "Oh, Lord," she had whispered, "you know everything. Nothing is hidden from you. Whatever the situation, whatever the hurt, you can heal it. Do it, Father. Have mercy on this man." He had looked up abruptly as she'd whispered that prayer, almost as if he'd heard her, though that could not have been possible. Their eyes had met for just a moment. Ginny had given him a slight nod. He'd nodded back, forced a smile, then looked back toward the door. For years he'd been coming, and waiting, although not in the outright anguish of the first time. Last year he had seemed more pessimistic, less hopeful. She wondered how much longer he would come, how much longer he would hope. She felt an urgency now, and it burst from her in prayer. "Lord, all things serve you," she murmured under her breath. "You hold everything together, and everything follows the counsel of your will. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, as the rivers of water he turneth it whithersoever he will. Turn these two toward each other, Lord. Bring them back together. I don't need to know about it. But do your healing, Lord. Fix these broken hearts." Susan cleared her throat. The waitress was at their table, smiling indulgently at the senile old lady mumbling to herself. "Will you have some dessert?" she asked pleasantly. And Ginny saw a way to buy herself another 20 minutes. "Why, I haven't had my birthday cake," she said as brightly as she could. The others couldn't deny her that. They readjusted themselves in their chairs, resigned. Ginny checked her own watch. "You would be here any minute now. Every year at 7:15. Another 5 minutes and he'd be rolling in. Anybody else have some dessert? She asked brightly. They shook their heads. I couldn't eat another bite, Susan protested. Ginny ignored the not-so-subtle hint. And to pacify them, she started gathering up her presents. She fixed her eyes on the doorway, and ignoring everything around her, she continued to talk to the Lord. Inside her heart, this time. At her age, you had to watch it. She continued to pray and keep watch, and just as the waitress was rounding the corner with the tiny little cake and the silly birthday hat and calling all the other waiters and waitresses to her table to sing, in he came, and she almost sang herself with relief. He was a very big man. Tall, around 6'2" or 6'3", she'd guess, and strapping. He was handsome, too, and Ginny clicked her tongue and gave her head a small shake at this. Handsome men could be problematic, used to getting their own way and such. Though Ginny's young man was certainly not hard on the eyes, she liked to think there was more to him than that. His hair was dark, his features bold. But there was something else about him that spoke of character to her, though she couldn't quite put her finger on what it was. It was just that he spilled out trustworthiness and competence, and although she couldn't say why, Ginny knew, if it ever came to such an eventuality, her life would be safe in his hands. He had a calm, steady face. Good, clean, honest lines to it. He looked at home in a suit, but at the same time, Ginny could picture him in work trousers, baling hay. She shook her head after considering that. He was used to hard work and sacrifice, that she could tell from his face, but there were clues that pointed to his being a professional man. For instance, although his navy blue jacket spanned wide shoulders, Ginny knew without looking that his shirt would be white and stiff with starch. And she would bet those competent hands had no calluses on them. He sat down now with an easy grace, shook his head at the menu being offered, never taking his eyes from the door. The waiters and waitresses were gathering around her table to sing Happy Birthday. He looked over and caught her eye. He flashed her a quick smile, but then her heart lurched as his face settled back into its resting position. For there was something different about it this year. The angry sadness and hopelessness had been incorporated into it, had become part of its landscape. He would give up soon if he hadn't already. She knew that, with a certainty that made her want to drop to her knees right there on the restaurant carpet. Because she also knew with a certainty she couldn't explain that he mustn't. Oh, Lord Jesus, she began, but was immediately interrupted by that silly birthday song. She shook her head with impatience as someone put the straw hat with the pink daisies on her head, and they began to sing. She endured it, smiling gracefully as the restaurant full of people cast indulgent glances at the cute old ladies still celebrating their birthdays. As soon as she could, she tore off the hat and mercifully, the singers all went away. She took a bite of the cake, and her friends all had a tiny slice, even Susan. The waitress refilled coffee cups, and Ginny prayed and nibbled, watching the man watch the feet and heads parading before him. Time passed. Marie got up and called her son to pick her up, and the others began dividing up the bill. The man took off his jacket. Just as she'd expected. His white shirt was crisply starched and ironed. He rolled the sleeves up to his elbow and loosened his tie, then took another sip of his tea. The waitress leaned over his table and spoke to him. He shook his head again. She took his bill from her apron pocket and set it down on the table. Then, just as Ginny was fixing to pack up her things and leave, the man tensed, and Ginny followed his gaze. It was a woman he was looking at. A woman's head, actually, because that was all you could see above the glass partition. This woman's hair was a mass of burnished red curls and piled in an untidy heap on top of her head. Ginny checked the man once again. He had half risen from his chair, his face alight with equal parts dread and hope. The woman came around the corner, then paused and scanned the dining room. Her eyes passed across Ginny's gentleman without any flicker of recognition and finally lit on the bunch at the round table in the center. She waved and went toward them. Ginny looked back at the man. His face had gone slack with disappointment. He sat back down, hard, looked away from the woman, and stared at the far wall for a moment. She could almost see him pulling the pieces of himself back together. He took a deep breath in, let it out, then reached for his wallet. Ginny rose up then. "Are you leaving?" Cora asked. "No," she answered quickly. "Are you going to the powder room?" Marie chimed in. "Wait for me, I'm coming too." But Ginny stepped away before Marie could get her walker arranged. She crossed to the table in the corner and stood in front of the man with the sad eyes. Blue, she could see now. Bright, clear blue. She had no idea what she'd say. But that had never stopped her before. "Help me, Lord," she whispered. He looked up from his bill, and Ginny couldn't help but notice he was a good tipper. He raised his eyes to her, his face polite but without a clue as to why she was speaking to him. She thought of different things to say. Didn't much matter, she realized. You could get away with a lot when you were 79. "Young man, do you mind if I sit down for a moment?" "No, ma'am," he answered, and was out of his chair in a heartbeat. He came around the table and held her chair out for her. He was raised well, she saw. Had no idea who this crazy old lady was, but was still eager to help her to her seat. "I want to speak to you," she said, after he'd gone back to his own side of the table. "Yes, ma'am." His face grew even more puzzled, but he nodded, sat back down, then waited politely. "I've been watching you," she said, deciding to come right to the point. He looked surprised at her bluntness, but then he nodded. "How was your birthday this year?" he asked with a little smile. "Did you get another subscription to TV Guide?" Ginny laughed and nodded. "Wouldn't be my birthday without it." He shook his head. "You know, that hat they put on you doesn't suit you at all. Reminds me of Minnie Pearl. I half expect you to shout howdy and say how proud you are to be here. It's not nearly elegant enough for a woman of your obvious refinement." "What hogwash." "Still," she smiled back. He was a very nice man. She had a flash of hostility toward the red-haired woman who belonged in the chair she had taken, but she quickly repented of it. Who knew what had gone on between these two? There are always two sides to every story. She knew that well enough. "Now listen," she started in, deciding to come to the point. "I've got a message for you." His face lit with surprise, which swiftly changed to puzzlement mixed with hope. Ginny could have kicked herself. "From the Lord, in a manner of speaking," she added, and watched the hope drain out of his eyes to be replaced with bemused interest. "Yes, ma'am." "No argument, no disbelief." She liked that. Showed he'd been taught something about the ways of the Almighty, even if the two of them didn't happen to be speaking at the moment. "Now is not a good time to quit praying," she said, repeating the thought that had been burning in her heart and mind. He stared at her, nonplussed. "That's it?" he asked. "That's the message from the Lord?" She nodded. "That's it." He took another one of his deep breaths. She had observed him long enough to know that that was what he did when he was discouraged. She felt the Spirit pressing her to do one more thing, and she didn't bother to argue. She'd finally learned it didn't pay to disobey. Might as well save a lot of time and heartache and do what he said to begin with. She laid one of her bony old hands on the pear in front of her. His eyes widened with surprise, but he didn't flinch or pull away. She clasped his hand, and he opened his palm and clasped hers back, his grip firm and warm. They were businesslike, competent hands, but, as she had guessed, there were no calluses on them. She held them gently and bowed her head right there in the crowded restaurant. "Lord Jesus," she said, "touch his heart. Touch hers. Begin right now drawing them back together with an invisible cord. Knot a thread through each one and just keep on pulling and pulling until they're back together again. Do whatever you have to do, Lord." She paused, waited for a minute, but no other words came. "Well, when you were finished, you were finished." He heard things the first time. "In Jesus' mighty precious name," she said. "Amen," he answered softly. She opened her eyes and met his gaze. His eyes were a little moist. She looked away to give him a chance to wipe them. Actually, she looked back to her own table. Cora was staring at her, mouth agape, and Marie was at her walker looking like she might toddle on over and join them. Ginny gave the man's hand one last squeeze and maneuvered herself up and out of the chair, waving him down when he rose. "I'll be praying for you," she promised, then turned and made her way back to the table. "What in the world?" Cora exclaimed. "Were you praying over there?" Marie asked.
"What happened?" Laura demanded.
"I didn't see."
"Let's go," Ginny said. "I'll tell you later."
It took them a few minutes more to gather their things and calculate the tip. By the time Ginny had left her $9.27 on the table, the man in the starched white shirt with the sad blue eyes was gone. Part 1. "Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home." Chapter 1. Sam stepped out of the inn into the dusky evening. Even though it had been sunny and warm today, the mountain air still held a misty coolness when the sun began to set. Everything here seemed clean and restorative, though he knew it was a mirage, a sleight of hand produced by the Almighty, which was ironic, as it was also his hand that was withholding what was needed. Rain, moisture, a taste of cool water. For these mountains, as well as the rest of the state, the entire southeast, for that matter, was in the grip of a vicious drought. For the last 3 years, it had not rained. Oh, they had seen the occasional thunderstorm and brief spatter of showers, just enough to make the plants rouse and send out their roots in hope, only to wilt, curl, and die when no moisture came. Last year alone, the rainfall had been 20 inches below normal. The creeks had dried up, springs turned to sludge. Farmers had lost their crops and sold off livestock. Another year of this, and some would lose their farms and homes. He wondered if there would be any relief. He scanned the sky now, hoping to see clouds. There was nothing but open blue blending to night's gray across the tree-covered tops of the Smoky Mountains, stretching off into the distance. His gut churned with the stew of conflicting emotions that coming here always produced. He slung his jacket over his shoulder and walked to the bluff at the edge of the restaurant's property. To the east was North Carolina, the place that had once been his home.
He could see Lake Junaluska, and beyond it, Maggie Valley, Gilead Springs, Waynesville, and Silver Falls. And beyond them, the lights of downtown Asheville glimmered in the dusk. Behind him, to the west, just over the ridgetop, was Tennessee, the place from which he had come just hours ago. The inn straddled two worlds, the same as he did. He took a deep breath and looked around. The woods were dense and beautiful, cool under their canopies of pine and oak, their floor a spicy-scented carpet of needles and leaves. Here and there, he could see a flash of pink rhododendron, shyly peeking through the green understory of leaves. They took his breath, these mountains, and he wondered how she was able to stay away. Though he supposed she could ask the same about him, should he ever cross her mind to that extent. He had been an exile these 5 years, as well, banished to Knoxville with its speeding traffic, its sweltering highways, its gleaming chrome and shimmering heat. He felt as if some angel with a flaming sword would bar the path should he even attempt to make his way back home. But whether he acknowledged it or not, these mountains always drew him, as if they exerted their pull directly on his heart. He gazed at the vista spread around him. The tree-covered hills of the Smokies undulated, dark green waves becoming teal and finally hazy blue in the distance. He knew their secret. It was the trees that made the hills hazy. They emitted hydrocarbons, which made the characteristic blue mist. He wished he did not know this. It bothered him. He much preferred the way he had felt about them as a boy. They were magical then, somehow, an ethereal, otherworldly place. They were not. He knew this now with certainty. He walked a ways, pushed through some low-growing brush, and looked down at the rocky tumble that used to be Smoky Hollow Falls. It had once been a thundering cascade, pouring down granite steps to create a crooked, frothing river that foamed over a rocky bed. Now, there was a weak trickle and patter of water, and the river was almost non-existent, just a sluggish, stagnant ripple. It would be better if it were gone completely. Then there would be nothing there to remind him of the way it used to be. Still, he remembered the white surge, the cool blue rivulets, the splashing foam as it cascaded down the mountainside, the swirling currents as it coursed among and over the boulders in its path. He wondered idly what it would be like if it began to rain again, if the skies opened and poured out their life-giving waters. He abandoned himself to imagine a slight spill and trickle of river becoming bigger and more urgent until finally it ran wild, filling, churning, spilling over the dry bed. He imagined what it would feel like if that rain began to fall. He could almost feel its first hesitant drops, then the drops becoming rivulets, drenching his face, soothing his tired body, a refreshing, cooling stream. He unbuttoned his collar and took a few deep breaths. He felt as if he were suffocating. Lately, he'd been having strange sensations and at the most inconvenient times. It was getting harder and harder to carry on without the grace that used to fuel him. 2 times last week, just as he was poised to press the scalpel down onto a tiny heart, he had suddenly glimpsed himself as if he were an observer to his own surgery. "What are you doing?" he had asked himself. "Who do you think you are?" And his hand had hesitated. No one had noticed except his scrub nurse, Florence, as old as dirt and guardian of many secrets. She'd glanced at him quickly, her faded gray eyes cutting sharply toward him over her mask, perhaps wondering if this would be the time his hand slipped or did not move quickly enough. Will you do it again? She seemed to ask. They all did. All those surgeries had gone off without a hitch, yet the incidents had troubled him greatly. He knew he'd been performing by the numbers for years now. 5, to be exact. Oh, he was still technically perfect, if no longer brilliantly creative. But lately he'd begun to be afraid. Of himself, he supposed. Though he wasn't sure exactly what that meant. Just that he felt as dry and cracked as the riverbed beneath him. And he knew he could be easily ignited if a flaming arrow hit target, no matter how calm he looked on the outside or how competently he still performed. Something vital that had protected him was gone. The well-oiled shield that used to quench those arrows and the willpower he had used in its place was wearing out. He put aside the troubling thoughts and turned his mind to the more immediate. He thought of the encounter he just had and shook his head, not sure if she'd been a senile old woman or a prophetess of God. He was leaning toward senile old woman. His heart gave an unexpected flare of grief at that conclusion. He looked up into the darkening sky. The stars were visible here. He was far enough away from city lights to see things clearly. He watched them for a moment. They looked fixed and immovable. But he knew the truth. Things traveled. Things shifted and changed. Nothing was for certain. Nothing stayed where you put it. He looked away from them, down to the graveled path beneath his feet. He had been coming here for 5 years, praying for 5 years. For 5 years, he'd been leaving messages, wooing her to return to the place where he had asked her to be joined to him until death parted them. And for 5 years, he'd been waiting. He remembered the foolish hope that had carried him through that first year. She'd been traumatized, he told himself. She just needed time to recover from the events that had torn both of their hearts to pieces. He had forced himself to give it to her, had kept himself fiercely in check, though he had not been able to keep from finding out where she was. He couldn't bear not knowing. He had not slept or eaten until he had heard for himself that she was safe. For that was his job, was it not, to care for her? To make sure that everything pertaining to her went as it should? He shook his head bitterly, aware of how miserably he had failed. He had hired an investigator, and it had been ridiculously easy for him to find Annie. He had located her in a matter of hours. Sam had known, even before she had called and left her terse message, that she was in Seattle at 201 Brady Way, Apartment C. He had known she had taken a job with the Seattle Times, that she was still driving his Ford truck. He had stopped after that. He had forced himself to be satisfied with knowing that she was safe, that she had the necessities of life. Beyond that, there was nothing he could do for her. He had left her name in all the bank accounts and had made sure each was well stocked. But she had taken nothing after that first $1,000. He had waited, marking the time on his calendar, sure that she would come back. When it had been nearly a year and their anniversary came, he had seized on the date as an excuse to contact her. He had composed his speech in his mind, had rehearsed it until it was perfect. He'd been confident that he understood her. She had been sad. She had been upset. But surely she was ready to talk to him now, to readmit him to her life. He had called 4 times and finally delivered his speech to her answering machine. Come home, he had said. Let me take care of you. Don't stay away, Annie. Come back to me. She had responded in kind, leaving a message for him, calling at noon when she must have known he would be working. All right, she had said. I'll see you. The words had opened the door between them even as her tight, fearful tone leaned against it. His hopeful heart had refused to admit the truth then, of course. But after the first few minutes that year at the inn at Smoky Hollow, he had known she would not come. He remembered how his spirit had sunk as he had sat and waited. He had realized then how much he had underestimated her grief and pain, her bitterness. He asked himself now why he had continued to come year after year, and he knew the answer. It was the only link left. To let it go would be admitting all hope was gone. He stared into the empty river gorge and thought of a play he'd seen once about a woman who stood every night at the doorway calling her dog. Finally, at the end, she'd come to a realization. Little Sheba wasn't coming back. And neither was the one he waited for. The finality of it hit him like a blow. He felt a flare of anger, though, not the dull resignation he would have expected. The fresh memory of the old woman's message came back to him. Now is not a good time to stop praying. He cast it off with a violent shake of his head. She wasn't a messenger of God, just a lonely old woman who'd been watching his little drama and thinking she heard from the Almighty. But it was just her own wishes she was putting words to. Besides, it was too late. He had already stopped praying. He couldn't remember when, exactly, but some time since he'd stood here last year this time, he had quit asking God for what was never going to be given. It was over. It was time to move on. He'd been a fool to wait this long. The realization had a hollow, bitter finality. But at least things would be settled now. He was finished. He wasn't ever coming back here again. He stared into the darkness, thinking about the mistakes he had made. And after a moment, he took off the ring he still wore on the third finger of his left hand. He reached into the breast pocket of his jacket, took out the small velvet box that contained his wife's wedding rings, set his own inside with them, and snapped it shut. Then he took out his keys and walked to his car. He drove, keeping his mind as blank as he could. He crossed the North Carolina-Tennessee border. When he neared the interchange for his apartment in Knoxville, he kept going, continued on past the city limits to the small suburb of Varner's Grove, and followed a familiar route. He had come here every day at first, watching, hoping, praying for some slight change, some shift in condition that would signal a reprieve from the crashing disaster, the wall of unthinkable error that had fallen down upon him from every direction. It had been to no avail. After a while, he'd begun coming once a week, then once a month. Part of him wanted to put it behind him now, to forget. But he could not do that, for like a cold shadow, it trailed him wherever he went. It was a ghastly reminder that once the hand slips, the mistake cannot always be repaired. He drove into the silent parking lot, empty of all but a few rows of old worn cars that belonged to the staff. He parked his own car, suddenly ashamed of its newness and comfort. He clicked it locked, heard the electronic chirp, and walked up the concrete entrance walk, past a concrete pot full of brown-tipped coleus and cigarette butts. Rosewood Manor was a state-run extended care facility. It was a sprawl of brick and concrete, of worn linoleum and scarred paint. It smelled bad, and it was where Kelly Bright had spent the last 5 years of her life. He walked through the automatic doors, past the empty reception desk to the nurse's station. He recognized the charge nurse as one of the kind ones, 50 or so, overweight, hair and skin drained to the same shade of sallow.
Helen, her name tag said. He greeted her and introduced himself. I remember you, she said, and he tensed, but the eyes she turned on him were compassionate. How are you, Dr. Truelove? She set her glasses on the mountain of charts before her. Fair to Midland, he answered, keeping his jaw locked tight against the truth. How is Kelly? She tipped her head, considering the answer that she was under no obligation to give. Would you like to see her chart? No. The answer was out abruptly. He felt horrified at the thought. She's doing very poorly, Helen admitted, her face sober. She has pneumonia again, and she has another urinary tract infection. Dr. Evers has her on antibiotics, but so far she hasn't responded. And she's still got the decubitus on her buttocks and heels, but those are the least of her problems. Sam received the news, heavy, unremitting though it was. All three conditions, pneumonia, urinary tract infections, and bed sores were the bane and result of Kelly's comatose state. Kelly's body continued to pump air in and out, receive nourishment, excrete it, and her heart and vessels performed beautifully. The final success of his repair a testimony to the exquisite cruelty of God. But her brain had gone silent and still, deprived of crucial oxygen while he fumbled. It had been in that state of suspended animation for just over 5 years. Sam walked down the scuffed hallway toward her room, his legs feeling heavy as lead. An ancient woman in a wheelchair barred his way. "Where's Donald?" she snapped. "Have you seen him? I told him to come straight home, and he's not back yet." "No, ma'am, I haven't seen him," he answered truthfully, and detoured around her. He passed a few more residents, nodded in greeting. A few greeted him coherently, and those were the ones he pitied most. Kelly's door was half open. He tapped on it. No one answered. He pushed it all the way open and went in, feeling the familiar dread. The lights were dim, the shades drawn. Marjorie, the charge nurse the last time he'd come, said they tried to keep it light during the day and dark at night, and somehow that disclosure had shocked him. That there might be a part of Kelly's brain that still knew or remotely cared whether the shades were up or down was a possibility that both tormented him and gave him a wild flash of irrational hope. She had a private room. He walked toward her bed. She lay quiet, her eyes closed, and for that he was thankful. It was worse when she mumbled and moved, as if there was someone still inside trying to find her way out. Though Sam knew it was an involuntary response, not purposeful in any sense of the word. There was a bouquet of balloons on the table in the corner. "Happy birthday," they said. He swallowed, his tongue thick. On the table beside her bed was a birthday card. "Happy 16th. He staggered inwardly, feeling as if someone had struck him. 16. She should be buying prom dresses and getting her first job, learning to drive. Not lying in Rosewood Manor day after day, week after week, year after year. But she did, and she would, and there was absolutely nothing Sam could do about any of it. Not now. He looked down at her. Her hair was short, not long and thick, as it had been the day he had first seen her. Her face was broken out in a few places, and that stabbed him too. The fact that her body continued to mature even though there was no point in it. Her weight was down, he noted, even without reading the chart. He wondered if the doctor in charge would increase the calorie count of the tube feedings. Her breathing was rough.
He could hear it even without a stethoscope. Her face was pale and gaunt. He came closer and forced himself to pick up the hand that lay contracted on the bedspread. He held it loosely in his own. "Good evening, Kelly. It's Sam," he said, sensing about as much response as he did when he prayed. He never said Dr. Truelove. Out of shame, he supposed. "I know it's been a while, but I just wanted to see how you're doing," he continued. "I hope you're not in too much discomfort." The words cut as they left his mouth. What a vile, cowardly thing to say. "I hope you're not in too much discomfort." Why, he ought to say the truth. "Kelly, I'm sorry. Kelly, if I could trade places, I would do so gladly. Kelly, forgive me. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry." He said none of these things, of course. For whose benefit would he say them? Certainly not Kelly's. Certainly not for her family, who crouched like sin at the door, ready to seize him by the throat when Kelly's short life ended. "They're waiting," his attorney had said. "They're poor, but obviously not stupid. They know they'll get more for her death than for her disability." He would have gladly given them all he had, but that would not even be allowed as a penance. His malpractice insurance would cut them a check. "It's Monday today, Kelly," he continued. "Monday, June 2nd. It was warm and sunny this morning, about like you'd expect for Tennessee this time of year. It clouded up a little this afternoon, but there was no rain. Now it's clear and cool outside. The wild strawberries are blooming up in the mountains." He felt suddenly cruel as those words left his mouth. Why had he reminded her of joy she would never experience again? And he felt guilty himself for even enjoying the thought of them. There was a shuffle at the door, and Sam stiffened. He had only crossed paths with the family once, and that had been early on. It had been the grandmother who had, thankfully, not recognized him. She had thought he was one of Kelly's doctors, which, in a sense, he supposed he was. This time it was the physical therapy aide, or so her name tag said. "I can come back," she volunteered. "No, that's all right," he told her, anxious to have a reason to leave. "Goodbye, Kelly." He aimed his words at the still, pale face. He could see the blue web of veins on her eyelids. She breathed in, out, no movement. No sign at all that she had heard him. He turned and left, and the feeling that overshadowed all others was weariness. He walked out into the parking lot, glad to leave the heavy, reeking air behind him. The cool night air felt good against his hot face. The crickets and tree frogs rang shrilly from the fields next to the building. He stood beside a spindly ash tree and rested his hand on the bark, happy to have something real and alive to touch. He had a sense that both of the situations that had overshadowed his life for so long were drawing to a close. The realization had a hollow, bitter finality. Kelly Bright had lasted longer than anyone had thought, and though it was possible that someone in a deep coma could live many years, he didn't think she would do so. It wouldn't be long now. Days, perhaps. Weeks. Months, at the most. He could tell somehow just from looking at her, from the ragged sound of her breathing, the moist pallor of her skin. And the other? Well, he had a feeling that the other had died long ago, and he had just never allowed the burial to take place. In fact, he knew the exact day his marriage had received its mortal wound. He could document it by the date in Kelly Bright's chart, for both had been collateral damage from another blow that still drained him white, left him speechless with pain. He dreamed the dream again that night. "Don't, Sam. You're in no shape to do this." He looked down, and there was Kelly Bright's heart and aorta, already exposed, the preparation having been done by his assistant and the chief surgical fellow. It was a simple job, at least for him. He would repair the tear the automobile accident had caused. It was a severe injury, but he could fix it. It was almost child's play compared to the complex defects he repaired on much tinier hearts as a matter of course. Everyone was waiting for him, and he was ready to begin when the telephone call came. The circulating nurse went to the wall, picked up the phone, then returned to him, her eyes welling, shaking her head. "You need to take this call, Dr. Truelove," she said. And he frowned with puzzlement, went to the telephone, lifted it up, and heard his mother's voice as he had never heard it before, telling him that his child had died. He listened to her wild narration again. "She was sleeping. I went to the telephone. I went to find her, and she was gone." Then the garbled details. The creak and paramedics and CPR and helicopters. And he could hear the hysteria in her voice. He could see her in his mind's eye there alone, waiting for Annie to come, waiting for him to come. He felt his blood being replaced with something cold, and he asked a few more questions. When his mother could not answer them, he asked to speak to the doctor in charge, and as he waited for him to come to the telephone, the calm overtook him. Oh, that calm. He could feel it seep into his heart and then spread through his arms and down to his legs and up to his brain. And he knew he would either pass out or become crystal clear and perfect. For it was a presence, cold and lifeless, a high white mountain of ice that calmed and cooled him. And his mind entered that blank white place he thought was flawless concentration. They were murmuring when he returned to the theater. All of them, the chief resident and the nurses and the anesthesiologist. He stripped off his gloves, and the resident said he'd call Dr. Hendricks to do the surgery. But Sam snapped on another pair, closing his mind to all but the problem before him, eager to keep it there, for he must not let it go anywhere else. "I can't do anything for Margaret," he said, still in that perfect coldness. "But I can save Kelly Bright." They looked at him, shocked, appalled, shaking their heads. Only Florence, his scrub nurse, was understanding. She put her hand on his arm. "Go home, Sam," she said firmly. "You're in shock. You're in no shape. You've contaminated me." He lashed her sharply with his words. But even then she didn't draw back. Just gripped him harder and said, "Go home. Let someone else..." The anger rose up then, a cold mercury anger, and he said, "Get out of my way. There is no one else." Even now, even in his lucid dream, the words burned like acid, their corrosive hubris eating him alive. "There is no one else who can do this better than me," he said. Then he regowned, regloved, took his place at the table, swept his eyes across every one of their eyes, challenging them as they peered at him above their masks with wonderment or compassion, disapproval or shock. He dropped his eyes away from theirs, then closed his mind to everything but the mess in front of him, the dissected aorta, which he must repair. "Forceps," he said, nodding to Florence, and it began, and the rest of the dream was the same. Predictable, a gruesome gray repetition, a horror film he knew the ending to and yet was forced to watch again and again and again. He saw himself unclamp the great arteries. "Off bypass," he said. And then he saw the stitches slip, her pressure drop, saw himself scramble to regroup, felt again the panic of his team, of himself. Saw his trembling hands, the beige gloves covered in blood,
saw them repair the tear, but only after the damage had been done. And he saw himself finally leaving the blood-soaked gown and gloves in a pile on the blood-pooled linoleum. Saw himself finally letting Barney drive him home to Gilead Springs. And he remembered that drive, his mind mauled, tossed between the two horrors like some dying creature being buffeted by its tormentors. He saw himself walk into the small hospital to find his daughter lying still and mottled, her hair still damp. He saw himself touch his mother's shaking shoulder, saw her shake her bowed head, saw himself going to his wife, knowing he should comfort her, but offering his arms and nothing more. He offered her nothing more because he had nothing more to give her. He had locked everything else up tight. For what would happen if he opened that floodgate? What would rush out? He still could feel Annie's hair pressed against his dry lips, could hear her voice, muffled and hot, asking, like Mary to the Savior, "Where were you? Where were you? If you'd only been here, my baby would not have died." And then the two of them were lying together, Margaret and Kelly Bright. And he woke to cold sweat, cold terror, both familiar companions. He lay still in the dark and listened to the sound of his apartment, to the hum of the refrigerator, the whir of the traffic outside. His heart and breath slowed, his sweat dried, and he wished over and over that he could tell himself it was only a dream. Chapter 2. At the exact moment in question, when she should have been, by all that was right, coming through the door of the inn at Smoky Hollow, Annie Ruth Dalton Truelove had been shearing a flock of Romney sheep. She had already taken the entire week off from her job at the Times, an unheard-of event. So when Jossie DeLorme had called and begged for her help, she had found her clippers and left before sunrise. She had worked all day, and at the exact time Sam had specified, 7:30 Eastern Time, 4:30 by the somewhat murky digital readout of her black plastic watch, she was finishing up her task, working on a particularly headstrong ram by the unlikely name of Hoochie Cooch. She was covered in mud, an occupational hazard of working outdoors in the double-minded Northwest, no matter what the time of year, and her boots were caked with dubious substances. She had a moment of heart-thudding yearning when she thought of him there, as she did every year on that day and on some in between, if the truth were told. But it was hard to pine while performing delicate maneuvers on the nether parts of a 200-pound ram. So she concentrated on the task at hand, and the moment passed. As they all eventually did. Her foolishness struck her now, the morning after. She was back in her real life, washed and dressed, and in her right mind, sheep shorn and wool on its way to yarn. She listened once again to his message, and she felt the searing awareness that the opportunity had been there once again. And once again, she had let it pass. She had intended to go. Again. She had made preparations, as she always did. She had taken vacation from work, even bought a dress, a pretty periwinkle blue, and a pair of opal earrings and necklace to match. She had packed her bag and made a reservation, as usual. But also as usual, her foot had hesitated before taking that final step, and before it landed on ground again. Jossie DeLorme had called and begged for her help. So yesterday, when she should have been there with him, she had been in Marysville shearing sheep. Something like panic gripped her now,
and for a moment she thought of rash, passionate remedies. She could call him. In fact, she could go there now instead of climbing onto the plane for Los Angeles. But today he would be busy. Today he would be angry that she had not come. Today he would be Dr. Truelove, and she an interruption. Yesterday had been her chance. She felt the panicked despair again. It was not too late. She could. She stopped. What was the use? Any new plot or contrivance always wound around to the same dead end. They could put both of their bodies in the same room, but until their hearts were changed, what was the use? His heart specifically. Hers was the same, she assured herself. She was the same girl he had married, right down to the last freckle. It was he who had become someone else, someone angry and obsessed. Someone she did not know, someone she did not care to know. She remembered what had changed him. And she felt her confidence waver, felt something gain on her, and she picked up the pace of her activity to keep ahead of it. She put the entire matter out of her mind. That's what you have to do, she told herself. Just get busy and think about something else. Think about today. She put on her beige suit, a concession to the business world, but draped a scarf under the lapels, gold with swirls of coral and rust. She had had another bad moment when she put on her amber necklace and earrings. Sam had given to her the morning after they were wed. She had awakened to find the small package on the pillow beside her. It was an old tradition, he had said. The morning gift. The groom's gift to his bride on beginning their first day as man and wife. She put them on now and refused to think about what they signified or who had given them to her. They were jewelry, nothing more. They went well with her hair. She leaned over and expertly twisted that hair into a bun, then rummaged on her dresser for a hairpin. She couldn't find one, and in desperation secured it with two pencils she grabbed from a jar on the bedside table. She would find the hairpins later. There were probably somewhere on the bottom of her bag, a voluminous black leather affair that held laptop, pencils, pens, notebook, wallet, address book, cell phone, the confirmation number for her electronic ticket, a bottle of water, a voice-activated microcassette recorder, a slightly mashed Snickers bar, a comb, and her entire cosmetic collection. Mascara and a tube of lipstick she could never find. She finished her packing quickly. She had packed so many times she could do it in her sleep, and sometimes she almost felt as if she had. She rolled her nightgown into a tight tube, shoved it alongside her walking shoes. She was quiet for a moment and listened to the sound of her apartment building waking up. She called it an apartment building, but really it was just a ramshackle old house, her allotted square in the middle on the second story. Upstairs, she could hear Mrs. Larson's television blaring out the weather channel. She checked her watch. She should check on her, remind her again of where she was going and when she would be back, so she wouldn't worry. She took one last inventory of her suitcase. They had said she would be entertained for dinner, and her stomach gave a twist. She checked. Yes, there was the dress she'd chosen. Had she gotten the shoes that went with it? Yes. Jacket? She wouldn't need one. It was Los Angeles, after all, and June. The only place it rained the whole blessed year was here in Seattle. She zipped her suitcase closed. Her stomach rolled and knotted, still trying to keep up with the impetuous action she'd taken yesterday morning. On her way to Jossie's farm, she had called Max Kroll and accepted his offer of an interview at the Los Angeles Times and changed the plane ticket from Asheville to L.A. It was time, she told herself, and she put aside the thought that the action she was thinking of, the one she fully intended to take, would change her life forever. They would take her even farther away from home, she realized with a lurch. She registered a small skip, a stutter at that word, home, not sure if she should apply it to the three furnished rooms in this Seattle apartment or to the place she hadn't seen in years, the place she could call up in a heartbeat by simply closing her eyes. She felt the strong tug of longing and a sharp pierce of pain, heard the rushing of the wind through the trees, felt the heat on her arms and face, saw the dense forest, the clouds of blue haze, smelled the sweet fragrance of apple orchards, tasted the sweet nip of iced tea. Well, life was all about making new choices, wasn't it? She talked to herself briskly and hoped Max Kroll would offer her the job as a feature writer for the Los Angeles Times. Then she could leave her temporary life here in Seattle. It was time to settle down and start a new life, forget the old one once and for all. She was ready. She switched off the light, took one last practice look around to see that everything was in its place, then flipped the lock and pulled the door shut. She stepped out onto the landing, left her suitcase by her door, and went upstairs. She knocked, and after a long minute or two, Mrs. Larson's wizened face peered out at her. Annie felt a rush of affection. She loved the old ones. There was something so peaceful about them. And she supposed it had to do with the fact that they had lived their lives for the most part. All the drama and heartache and misery was behind them. She envied them that. "Oh, hello, dear." Mrs. Larson undid the latch and opened the door. "How are you today?" Annie shouted. Mrs. Larson was a little hard of hearing. "I'm fine. Won't you come in and have a cup of coffee?" "I'd love to," she said, "but I've got a plane to catch. Remember?" "Oh, yes." A pleasant smile, a blank look. "Did you remember to take your medicine?" The eyes clouded in confusion. "Let's just look and see." Annie smiled encouragingly, and Mrs. Larson stepped back, happy just to have another few minutes of company. Annie went into the kitchen and found the slotted box of pills she had loaded up the day before. The morning dose was gone.
"I took them. I remember now."
"Well, you must have. They're gone."
"Yes. Yes, I did. I took them with my tea and toast."
"Are you sure?"
"Yes, I'm sure."
"All right. Now don't forget to take the ones at lunchtime."
"Oh, I won't."
That pleasant, sweet look returned, and Annie's heart ached. Mrs. Larson needed to be with someone who could take care of her, not living right by herself. She had a daughter close by who rarely visited, and Annie fumed for a minute, then remembered, "Thou shalt not judge." Besides, her ears would probably be ringing if she could hear what they said about her back home. The lady preacher Mrs. Larson loved joined in their conversation from the television set. "The God of this age has blinded an awful lot of people, and I'll tell you something. A blind person can't see things the way they really are," she pronounced. "You may think you see things right, but the truth is, unless Jesus lets you see things the way they are, you may be headed for a pit." Annie felt a stirring down beneath her ribs. It was not a good feeling.
"All right, then," she said to Mrs. Larson. "I'd better be going." "Oh, must you?"
"I'm afraid so." She gave Mrs. Larson a quick hug and kiss, then waved goodbye from the landing. She glanced once again at the lady preacher who was still talking.
"Don't let the God of this age distort your vision. Ask the Lord to let you see the truth."
She went down the stairs, and the lady preacher's voice faded. Poor Mrs. Larson. 5 minutes from now, she'd have forgotten Annie had even been there. She wondered what it would be like to walk a while in Mrs. Larson's shoes. Her parents had come to Ballard from Norway when she was 5. "Have you ever been back?" she had asked her once. "No," Mrs. Larson had said, her eyes unfocused as she tried to recall that place. It had struck Annie how sad it was to lose sight of your home, and in spite of her resolve, she heard the preacher woman's voice echo again. She went back downstairs, then knocked on the door of the apartment next door to her own, and after a minute, the door opened. "Annie!" Adrian smiled with blinding welcome, and Annie's heart lifted, as always. "Here you go, darling," she said, handing Adrian the key to her front door. "Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you!" Adrian jumped up and down. "I wasn't sure you'd remember." Annie shook her head and clicked her tongue. "Adrian, I thought you had more faith in me." Adrian grinned. Her braces were purple this week. "Are you sure you don't mind?" she asked, an expression of desperate hope on her face. "My mom said I was imposing." Annie smiled and shook her head. "Are you kidding? It's an honor to have my humble abode used for your 13th birthday party." "Just don't burn it down." "You're the best, Annie." Adrian threw her arms around Annie, and Annie hugged her back, her heart giving a twist. She would miss Adrian, and for just a moment it seemed like reason enough to stay. She patted the freckled cheek, like her own in that respect. In fact, she realized again, Adrian looked enough like her to be her daughter. They had the same red hair, the same upturned nose and tilted eyes, though Annie's were gold-speckled green and Adrian's brown. "Cat eyes," Ricky Truelove had teased her. She picked up her suitcase, then headed down the stairs, pushing thoughts of Sam's younger brother back where they belonged. "Your presents on the kitchen table," she called back to Adrian. "Don't open it till tomorrow." "I promise," Adrian called after her. "Right. You'll be up there before I'm out of the building," Annie called back. The three packages on her kitchen table contained a set of 12 lip glosses in shades of pink and orange, a silver bracelet with a large letter A dangling from the catch, and a crazily striped scarf she had knitted herself. All right. She'd gotten a little carried away. She was just sorry she wouldn't be here for the party. She could have made the cake and decorated the apartment. She thought about balloons and streamers for a minute before she took herself to task. Adrian was somebody else's child, not hers. She thought about Adrian's life shuttling back and forth between two rooms, two parents, two lives. It couldn't be easy, but then no one's life was. Everyone carried their heartache, some on the outside where it showed, and others more privately. She drove to the airport, left her car in long-term parking, then got on the plane to California. She sipped coffee, ate the Snickers bar for breakfast, doing her best to peel away the wrapper, which had become one with the caramel and chocolate, then took out her laptop and wrote up some questions for the next interview she would do with the mother of two autistic sons. She tried to imagine what it would be like to look at their closed faces and know you could never enter in. She did not trivialize her pain enough to believe that she understood it, but she had an idea. She remembered that feeling of being shut out, the hopelessness of appeal. She thought about the work she had chosen and wondered why she did it. Not just the night she worked through in yet another cheap motel, the gallons of coffee she'd drunk, the miles she'd logged in airplanes and rented cars, but the work itself, the dark tunnels she traveled, the grimy, gritty places she explored and the lonely souls she found there, whose stories she tried to tell with grace and compassion. This was not what she had imagined herself doing. She had pictured herself writing lovely things, pure, beautiful works, full of virtue and grace. Instead, she had written about a week of life in a migrant workers' camp, about riding in the back of a cramped van with illegal Mexican immigrants, about shadowing a Seattle police vice officer for a week and then telling of the toll it took on her mind, her health, her family, recounting the story of the first murder in a small island town in Washington and following its ripples of pain. Perhaps these stories were not lovely, but they were true, and she wove them the same way she'd once woven tapestries, stretching the warp of truth tight so the pattern could emerge upon it. She had not even known there were such stories when she had been dreaming her dreams, much less that they would become her dwelling place, a misty half-world that would become her native land. But there were people who lived there, and their stories deserved to be told, their pain honored. They deserved a witness. But she had not imagined herself as their voice. She had imagined herself dwelling in the kingdom of light, not among the shadows. Oh, my! But she had been idealistic. And she gave a wry smile at the way life dealt with ideals, the effect of reality on dreams. She shook her head and ignored the twist in her stomach that hadn't left her since the day before. Since 5 years before. She tried not to think about the ache that said she was out of sync, out of place, that she had missed something important, that she was not in her native land after all, no matter how natural this one might seem. The plane landed. She got out of her seat, took down her overnight bag from the overhead compartment, and stepped outside. The air was balmy and warm. Palm trees lined the airport driveway. She raised her arm, and a cab drove up beside her and stopped. 202 West 1st Street, she told the driver, after settling in the back seat. He was Indian or Pakistani, she guessed by his dress and the name on the license hanging from the visor. He nodded wordlessly and pulled away from the curb. Los Angeles was buzzing and bright. Nothing like the damp gloom she'd left in Seattle. She rolled down the window to let the hot wind sweep her face. But the traffic sounds were loud, and the air smelled like exhaust. She rolled it back up again. They snaked through a maze of freeways, starting, stopping, starting again. She checked her watch. She was cutting it close, but she would make it. She put her anxiety aside and looked out the window. Southern California was dry and dusty, and not beautiful, at least not anywhere near here. Chain-link fences topped with razor wire lined the freeway. The concrete walls of the buttresses were covered with swirls of graffiti and boldly colored artwork. Well, there were stories here. That much was obvious. Maybe not pretty stories, but then, whose really were? The cab turned off the freeway, and after a few more turns, they were downtown beneath a maze of concrete high-rises. The sidewalks were clotted with businessmen and women, and crowds of tourists with camera necklaces, the corners adorned with palm trees looking stressed and out of place, and everywhere cars and haze. The cab pulled to the curb and stopped. She paid and asked for a receipt. He grumbled, scribbled it out, then roared away as soon as she was out and the door was shut. She stood there for a moment, looking around her. There was nothing familiar here, nothing that moved her or caught at her heart. She could live here. She entered the lobby of the Times building, grateful to be out of the smog and heat, and checked her watch. She had time to freshen up. She found the restroom as well as her lipstick and hairpins,
but not without emptying her entire purse onto the washroom counter. She colored her lips with the cinnamon lipstick, rubbed a tiny dab onto each cheek, dashed a little mascara across her lashes, combed her hair and wound it up again, and looked a sight better without the yellow pencils. She could hear Ricky Truelove's voice taunting her in that long-ago childhood. "Better be dead than red on the head. Better be dead than red on the head." She smiled, thinking of her brother-in-law, as close to a pesky little brother as she would have in this life. Mean as a snake and wild as a jackrabbit. And she would love him until the day she died. Why didn't she tell him? She shook her head, gathered up her things, and arrived in Max Kroll's office 5 minutes early. She announced her arrival to the receptionist, accepted her offer to stow the suitcase, then sat down to wait. She occupied her mind with a few story ideas she'd been rolling around. It never paid to let things sit in neutral for very long. The moss started to grow when things took root. She rummaged around in her purse for notebook and pencil, flipped past other notes, located a blank page, and wrote quickly before she lost her train of thought. She was interrupted by the clearing of a throat. "Annie?" She looked up. The managing editor had come out to greet her himself. He was around 50, paunchy, with a plummy voice, sharp eyes, and brows that looked like old toothbrushes, wiry and white. They had met only once before, at the Washington Press Club dinner before the Scripps Howard Awards, one of which had gone to her. She still felt astounded to realize that. She had listened in stunned disbelief as the award had been announced. "The prize for feature writing is awarded to Annie Ruth Dalton of the Seattle Times for her intimate, beautifully written stories of American life." Max Kroll had introduced himself to her at that dinner and followed up a few months later with a note expressing admiration for her work and an invitation to visit the Times. Kroll was watching her now, looking amused. She wondered how long he'd been standing there waiting for her to look up. "Good to see you again," she said, easily pulling out the greeting from the collection of conversation starters she carried along with her spare discs and pencils.
"You too," he said. "Never take a day off, I see."
Glancing at her notebook. "Not if I can help it." She shoved it into her bag.
"Bad for you. You'll drop dead one day."
She felt a grim shock at his words, though she had long ago learned to let those careless cruelties slide off. They didn't know. They didn't understand. How could they? "We all will," she said softly, and followed him into his office.
"This is the features department," Max Kroll announced.
It was the last stop on their tour.
Annie stood at the doorway and stared as if she were on hallowed ground. But actually, now that she gave it a good look, it was just like any other newspaper room. Bigger, maybe, but still just a crowded mess of desks and computers, snaking cords and busy people. There was the electronic chirping of telephones, the low din of noise, the hum of energy common to any newspaper. But this wasn't just any newspaper, she reminded herself. It was the Los Angeles Times, one of the top four newspapers in the country. And they wanted her. That fact had finally been stated in the conversation she and Max Kroll had just concluded.
"This'll be your desk," Kroll said, leading her toward a metal desk.
Annie smiled. She had not told him yes, but she felt a flush of pleasure at being courted so determinedly.
"The woman you'll be replacing is on assignment in Mexico, and her actual departure date isn't for another month or so, but we can find something for you to do in the meantime if you want to start sooner."
She sat down at the desk and fingered the keyboard of the new computer.
tried to imagine what it would be like to be anchored in one place, to put down some roots, to put forth leaf and perhaps fruit. Is this the famous Annie Dalton? The voice hit her ears before her eyes saw the body. She bristled a little and turned. Jason Niles, the man said, smiling and extending his hand. There was no mockery on his face, only pleasant interest. Ah, her boss-to-be, who had no reason to be mocking the likes of her. He had made a big mark of his own, writing everything from hard news to soft features. He had worked for the Associated Press and had finally won a Pulitzer a few years back for his reporting on 9/11. She had read those pieces herself. They were incisive, eloquent, and moving without being maudlin. So he had decided to cash in his chips and stay put for a while, as well. She gave him a sharp look, interested to put a person with the name. He was tall, 6'2" or 6'3", slim and tanned. He looked to be in his early 40s with blonde hair thinning a little at the sides. Annie Dalton, she said, reaching out to shake his hand. But you already know that. I'll leave you in Jason's capable hands, Max Kroll said. He'll give you the details on dinner tonight. They said their goodbyes. Max Kroll left. Jason Niles took her on a tour of the features department. She met a parade of people whose names she was sure she would sort out eventually. He took her out to lunch at a Japanese restaurant, not far from the paper. She wasn't hungry, but she pretended to eat, picking at her food, listening attentively to his stories, making a comment from time to time. She steered the conversation to her stories, her education, keeping it well away from dangerous personal ground. It came near only once. I enjoy hearing you talk, Jason said. May I ask where you're from? North Carolina, she said. The western part, near the Tennessee border, where the Blue Ridge meets the Great Smoky Mountains. Near Asheville? He asked. That's right, she said, and smiled. I visited there a time or two. It's beautiful country. It's the most breathtaking place on earth, she said. And then she felt embarrassed. How about you? She asked quickly. Where are you from? San Fernando Valley, born and raised. Not breathtaking. She smiled. Did you go to college here, too? She asked. And they were off again, back on safer ground of jobs and schools. Finally, he escorted her back to Max Kroll's office so she could get her suitcase and take a cab to her hotel. A hot shower sounded good. And getting out of her grown-up shoes. I'll expect a lot from you, he said. But I'm sure you can deliver. Your work is excellent. She felt a flush of pleasure at his praise. Thank you. It's a wonderful opportunity. Yes, it is. He gave her another one of his pleasant looks, and she wondered if there was more to him. There must be. I'll pick you up at your hotel for dinner at 7, he said. I'll be waiting in the lobby. He nodded, lifted a hand in goodbye, and the elevator doors closed. She picked up her suitcase and called for a cab to take her to the hotel, then waited outside for it to arrive. The traffic surged by, and the buildings rose up around her like tall columns of rock, people boxes, and she tried to think how many humans were represented by each glass square. She tried to look beyond the clutter of buildings toward the mountains she knew ringed the city, but she could not see them. She tried to imagine herself making a life here. She could, she told herself. She could. The hotel was a high-rise in the heart of downtown. She could look from her window and see the Civic Center, the Staples Center, a couple of other hotels, and countless office towers. She saw cars darting forth and surging back, ant people crawling along the sidewalk.
She turned around and inspected the room. It was nice. Well, that hardly described it. The walls were lovely, glowing gold, the artwork tasteful, and the brown leather chairs looked like the real thing. There were fresh flowers and a bowl of fruit on the table. She thought of the rooms the Seattle paper rented for her when she went out of town to cover a story. Then it was Motel 6 or Super 8 all the way. Well, la-di-da, she thought, smiling. And she suddenly remembered the way Sam had courted her. So gallant and chivalrous. And she remembered him taking her to the ridge behind the inn at Smoky Hollow and holding her hand on the night he proposed. "I want to give you a beautiful life," he'd said. "I want to make sure nothing ever hurts you." And he had kissed her hand and put his grandmother's diamond ring on her finger. They had both been foolish to believe that was possible, hadn't they? She thought of what he had said when he had asked her to come to the inn that first year, and how the words had rung in her ears even after she had said she would. "Come home," he had said. "Let me take care of you. Let me fix it," he might just as well have said. Her mouth suddenly dry, she went to the minibar and took out a diet soda, then unpacked her suitcase. The dress she had brought was gold silk. It would need to be ironed. She took off her suit and hung it up, put on the thick terry cloth robe the hotel had hung in the closet for her, then lay down for a few minutes. She closed her eyes, determined to rest. But after a while, she realized she was scrunching them shut and giving herself a headache. She sat up, tired but resigned that she would not relax enough to sleep. She hesitated a moment before digging out her address book and looking up her sister's telephone number. She dialed. Her brother-in-law's bass voice boomed from the answering machine, and she felt a burst of relief that she would not have to speak to him in person, at least not right now. She left a message, the hotel's telephone number, her room extension. "I hope I can see you tomorrow," she said, "before I go back to Seattle." She got up and paced the room. She felt odd, excited but bored, tense but tired. She thought about taking a hot bath but decided to take a walk instead. The quietness of the room was working on her nerves. The hotel was soundproof, and even though there were hundreds of souls around her, she could hear nothing but the muffled opening and closing of a door now and then. She put on her jeans, a t-shirt, her walking shoes, then put her room key card in her pocket, slung her bag over her shoulder, and left. She walked to the transit center by Union Station, where she watched the buses arrive and depart, not sure where she wanted to go. She studied the list of possible destinations. North Hollywood? No. She didn't want to look at anybody's name on a sidewalk. Beverly Hills? No. No movie stars or exclusive shops. Chinatown? No. Santa Monica?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.